Okay, let's have another look at Paul Hall. Work on my pronunciation. Thing about pronunciation is the pronouns. Actually, it's supposed to be pronunciation. Hey, I don't have that much trouble with pronouns. It's the verbs. Is that pronunciation? Yeah, I need to work on my pronunciation. Anyway, let's take a look at, another look at the Paul, that's proper pronunciation. Paul Hall Art website. Okay, let's scroll down and take another random look at the Paul Hall Art homepage. Home on the Range. Let's see. It's about what it really looks like. F11. Alright. We're page downing here. That was Portrait of an Algebraic Equation. Let's take a look at Last Leaves here. A painting from Memories of Sitting on one of the huge glacial erratic boulders in Central Park in New York, one late autumn afternoon. Watching a little willow tree, the last one that autumn to still have leaves, shedding them into the water of the small lake. It was the autumn when the first blackout happened in New York City, 1965. There it is, Last Leaves painting, oil painting. Those autumn leaves drift by my window. Those autumn leaves are red and gold. Last Leaves. Oil on canvas, Manhattan period, autumn 1965. I remember painting this in the McBurney branch of the YMCA. during my time at the School of Visual Arts in New York City. I spent a lot of time in Central Park. My first residence was in a dormitory style. Accommodation at McBurney Branch YMCA on East 23rd Street in Manhattan. I was getting little or no artwork done after school except for a few portraits. Others done in the dorm, you know. After coming back one day and finding a rock on my bed which had been thrown from the street six stories below, that was the last straw, and I got one of the tiny private rooms where I lived for a couple of months. There in this small room listening to classical music and Joan Baez albums, I did a few paintings. Residing there during the great blackout of 1965. It was there I did this painting from memory. I was sitting on one of the huge erratic glacial boulders, admiring its texture and marveling at the wonderful job the fog was doing, making the apartment buildings on the west side seem like palaces. Yeah, these apartment buildings on the west side, there's like the kind of buildings that were used in the movie Ghostbusters 1. Remember, I don't know if you guys remember that. Here's the little willow tree. There's the erratic. I guess it's not an erratic, it's this huge scraped boulder there. And I had geology in high school, so. You know. It was autumn. In those days, before global warming was bantered about as myth or fact, the climate was colder. It's like, I know you're reading on with me here. Whatever. Who's arguing? It was cold. okay, da-da-da. I sat there in the cold doing my job. I was observing, that's my description on my channel page. I was enjoying the beautiful golden color of a brave little willow tree growing near the water. It was the last tree to lose its leaves, and it hung on to them fiercely and begrudgingly, it seemed, surrendering them almost one by one into the waiting water. Now there are movements afoot, it seems, these days that cater to those who want only the thoughtless exercise of realistic detail in all art and nothing but, you know, the artist pandering to their demands becomes reduced to a tin pan alley magician producing one dry academic exercise of unfeeling realism after another. But in this painting, I paint a memory. It's my memory of the rock, the buildings vanishing in the fog, and that brave little willow tree. I have many such memories now in my, well, then it was 54-year-old mind. Now it's 10 years later, man. Talk about a tenure. Anyway, most of which I didn't have the same opportunity to jump on, you know, onto the canvas. It's that of the little willow and its last leaves in that tiny room back in 1965. One day there was a riot in the TV lounge, started by a local West Side gang of young men. Yeah, it's just like out of West Side Story. You gotta be kidding me, man. I was in the lobby waiting for the elevator.
Well, I took the stairs.
The incident helped me to realize that I was going to need some more space if I was going to be productive. In other words, I got out of there and went down to my own apartment, you know, the heck with this thing.
You got to go to the YMCA, I want to tell you, man, young man.
Yeah, young man grew up a little bit.
Oh, I need my own studio where they don't have fist fights in the lounge.
Yeah, I decided to get an apartment, which turned out to be a great move because I was to get more done in that apartment than I was ever able to do in one place like that ever since. You know, it was my little window on the future. And that's Last Leaves. And this is the, you'll notice the background is kind of beautiful there, isn't it, huh? That's the little picture there that I worked on, that little photo, digital photo on in Photoshop. And nothing like reality. Here's some cute little buttons I was working on. I was treating my buttons like fine art. See, look at this next button. Isn't that cool? I got a granite next button here. It's like, next place. Hey, it still works. That's the portrait of Franz Klein brushstroke. Look at that brushstroke, man. This is actually one single brushstroke by the artist Franz Klein. He used to use these huge brushes, you know. And what I saw was like, this is part of the edge of this brushstroke, which actually was just black on white, you know. So I did this painting, a portrait of it. But anyway, let's get back now. I wonder if I have my little buttons down there. Man, this is pretty good. I'll have to read that for you one day. Previous. Dun, dun, dun. It works. Last leaves. Leave me a dome. Yep. Actually, I hitchhiked. I was like, I had to get my, you know, like, I was almost late for my appointment to get a job as a lifeguard that summer. You know, I went through this autumn and then the winter in my dad's army field jacket, and guess what? I wore that field jacket in New York City and it started a style which is going to this day of guys using army surplus stuff. In those days you would never do something like that, but yeah, Dad let me have the field jacket, and man, that was my coat, and it worked, you know, so could have been better, but hey, it doesn't get that cold in New York. The buildings focus the wind, though, and now I'm able to work with these colors, you know. The colors toned down into browns and grays. And so that I can concentrate on this little willow tree. As you know, I'm sitting here and I can actually see the scene. It's kind of like, some of your memories are almost like, you know, remote seeing through time. Tell you something about this, folks. Your human characteristic, and not just brains, a whole bunch of other things there. I think there may be a huge amount of things that are invisible, but are nevertheless part of you that's able to do incredible stuff. Absolutely incredible. Somehow we're all toned out of it. It's like blocked out. So lastly, there's one more thing I wanted to show you real quick. Let's try it. It's got a link here. There it is, the brave little willow tree. The brave little willow tree. As I sat there on the huge rock and took in the scene, I couldn't help but notice the lovely willow with its gentle leaves both on the tree and falling into the lake beneath until the waters were transformed by the golden leaves scattered on the surface. I returned from my travels last month, in the last month of 1989, to care for my aging mother. We finally landed in a mobile home I had mortgaged in West Claremont, New Hampshire. There she lived out the last 9 years of her life. This was one of her favorite paintings. She had it framed earlier, and finally it was hanging prominently in her room, where she would see it as she lay in her bed during her last days. So in a way, she was sort of like that little willow tree, bravely holding out till the end. You know, if it weren't for her, much of my website, Paul Hall Art, much of this wouldn't have been possible, that deals with all these examples of my earlier work. And, you know, especially stuff that I was doing paintings of the future, I would have never been able to realize that. It's like, yeah, I tell you, it is not cool to live in oblivion, you know, like this oblivious attitude, like, whatever, let's just do the painting, you know. It's like, no, this is like, do this painting and you'll be there. Ta-ta-da. Or even work, you know, like, work on, boys, even further than that. So anyway, I digress. If it weren't for her, you know, like, I mean, we got the examples. If it wasn't for her, she went through all kinds of stuff to save this. At one point, she had to move out of one apartment to another. Yeah, the stepfather is like, this bohemian guy. All they could afford, but they did it. They managed to do it. They managed to move in a dumpster, a Dipsy dumpster, you know. Just filled it up. The truck came in. Puts it on its bed, you know. And they moved in a garbage truck. Okay, anyway, they did it though. Okay, so if it weren't for that, man. Since she was the one that worked so hard to preserve the artwork all through her divorce, many, many subsequent moves, you know, she had given so much to make this possible. A little while after she died, I saw her in a dream. She had, I forgot this, she had brought Vincent van Gogh along, you know. It's like, yeah, I want you to meet my son. So she's in the dream, and here's Vincent van Gogh with this look on his face like, whoa, you're kidding me. Yes. Oh, hi, Vincent. You know. So anyway, so there you are. Death isn't the end. Soon the spring will return, and with it, the new life in the little willow. So you copy on that one, huh? Yeah, she showed up in the dream, and she brought Vincent van Gogh with her. You know? So, when we left, I still hadn't been able to afford the funeral. Though one of her good friends had lent me some funds, it helped to pay for the cremation. So, mother's ashes came along with Jen and I, or me, in the cab of the rental truck we used to take what little we could along with us across the entire United States from New Hampshire to Southern California. You can have a look at that. I did a cover for, Woody Guthrie's This Land Is Your Land. And it's really, the melody actually comes from an old 19th century folk hymn. But, like, what you gonna do when the world's on fire and stuff like that. You know, that's what it really was. This sung by a group called the Weavers or something way back. It was like, anyway, the group was whatever the little choral group was that made that old song famous before Woody did his version of it. One of the girls was the lady who married Johnny Cash and saved him from all kinds of stuff that later on Cash became a pastor. Anyway, so anyway, we went to SoCal, Southern California. We didn't go to SoCal. Actually, Jen went to Gemological out there in Carlsbad. But anyway, yeah, you can check that out. I did the cover of it's called This Land Is Your Land, you know. Just type that into the address bar, Paul Hall Art, all lowercase, no caps. So it is that she has finally returned to the state where she got started way back in the early years of the 20th century. She was born in San Francisco, you know. Now her little black box sits atop the bookshelf in our apartment until the day when hopefully we can tear her ashes in some little marked grave in San Francisco where she was born. And this was written back in, let's see, 04. Yeah. And here's a little portrait of the mother of the Willow, Marcel Paul. There's a ballpoint pen on paper. It's like, I think it looks like, it is. Newsprint paper. That blue part, you see, is fabric of the lawn chair. I took a photo of this, put all this stuff on a lawn chair. This is probably a piece of tile that I use as a paperweight to keep it from blowing in the wind. One of the best ways to get away take a shortcut from getting into all the technicalities that were involved with chemical film, or even digital art film, digital whatever, memory, indoors, it's really almost impossible to shoot artwork, to take photos of artwork indoors without special kind of lighting. There's this thing called this Kelvin rating or something else. You gotta really know, but you can take the stuff outside and in natural sunlight it always turns out okay. Isn't that weird? So the problem was, it was almost sunset when I took the picture, and this, I put it on the lawn chair to get the angle of the sunlight correct. But anyway, so yeah, that's Mother Marcel did this portrait while she was doing, you know, sewing a sewing repair on my, you know, sort of London Fog type trench coat that I was wearing to cross the borders between USA and Australia in those days, last days of my travels. Okay. So I did that quick sketch of her when she was repairing the coat of mine before I took off my last trip to Australia and New Zealand in 1987. I started writing books then. Anyway. So, follow this link back to this, and we just have time for maybe one more. Let's have a look at this part here. Luxury apartment buildings on Fifth Avenue West, emerging from the fog. Sitting on the rock in Central Park on that chilly autumn day, I was doing what I have done best as a child. I would find a place and remain there, very quiet, and just look, you know. I mean, does everybody do that? Or does anybody do that? Well, I'm one of the anybodies who doesn't, so. It could have been a treetop, you know, like top of the cherry tree in Bad Homburg, Germany when I was 8 years old. That old tower in the middle of a field upon whose battlements I stood, licking powder Kool-Aid from the palm of my hand also in Bad Homburg. Or the cliff top where I used to camp out in Danbury, Connecticut when I was 15. Or the rowboat with my dog Tober on tiny Lake Wakawana. I looked it up, that means lots of water, I guess. There's not that much water in that lake. Somebody else must have named it, you know. And so, anyway, so also in Danbury, Connecticut, or in the huge live oak trees in Charleston, South Carolina. The secret is in the stillness. You have to get perfectly still and wait. Then the forest transforms into a voice that you can hear with your mind. Telling you something, this is a reality. But you have to get quiet first. A lot of times it doesn't take long. Sometimes it does. Sometimes you'll walk away having only benefited from the peacefulness. But most of the time, in about 27 minutes, you'll be in touch. Is it better? A better way to be compared with what? I mean, there aren't words to describe this. In English, it gets lost in translation, but something like light, water, ocean, mercury, silver, pouring stars, distance, greater peach, went tomorrow's on arcs and space dust plants here, say you are growing. And that's not even close. I really irk a lot of people because, you know, I try. When I come round to something, it defies their kempt, inaccurate, biased logic. So I tell this to you, it would be your strength. Maybe in the silence is sanity, like a hard drive defragmenting, you know. Maybe you don't know what that is anymore, they do it automatically. But I'm sure there's really something to it. If you get to be rushing around and really busy, you may feel great. You may imagine yourself to be competent, but those are illusions commonly held. Dang, you know, it's almost like I'm writing this to myself. Anyway, now I got to get up on the roof and just sit there for a while. It's a good view. You can actually see the ocean out there. And that ocean, by the way, from the view here, is the Bermuda Triangle, or BT itself. But anyway, hey, would that make me a BT Nick? Anyway, so, those are illusions commonly held. Art is not that. In the quiet, you get something that you bring in, seasoned with your personality, but you've brought in the beyond, you see. You brought in the beyond. What is not you, but something you're a part of. Or would you rather be some sort of biological fragment living in a broken machine with blatant hostility hiding behind its myriad of masks? Oh, maybe I can put this in writing because I'm a little older now. I can work with a bit of a frame of reference. I can make a statement that's somewhat reliable and useful. Get quiet! Get quiet! Get away from the screams, from the hype, from the social climbing, from the, you know, the sense of achievement, from the machinery, and sit on your rock, wait beneath the stars, and become a part of what you're made of. Enjoy being the outcast. It's an emergency. Why delude yourself? Look at reality and wait for it to speak to your being. In the quiet, sitting on the rock in Central Park, forever covers the city until only the nearby apartment buildings emerge like castles of some bygone era. I get comforted from my grief at having to leave the forests and Tober. He remained with my family, by then in Long Island, but soon he too died, hit and run. Only a dog, they must have thought. I still see him in my dreams. There, I can give him a hug. Yeah, the last leaf painting is a little more than you thought, huh? That's a blinky. Little oil painting here. Now, this was back in the days when your umbers, like this, this is burnt umber, and this is raw sienna. And this, I think, is Naples yellow. No, not Naples yellow. Yellow ochre. Beautiful, isn't it, huh? And this, I forgot how I got the blue. I think I put some cerulean blue in with some of the, burnt umber and some of the titanium white. So everything is different shades of gray. this thicket over here, I wonder what's in there. The thicket beside the rock. There were lots of places in the park that had examples of different types of shrubbery. This was something I remembered when I got back and started the painting. Everything had lost all their leaves except the little willow tree. That's really something. I wonder if they have something about the sky up here. They, meaning me, the foggy sky Actually, you see, there are two parts to the foggy sky that the fog is covering. To the left, the skyline of Lower Manhattan is covered. To the right, it's the uptown part of Manhattan, leading to the northern tip of Manhattan Island, Harlem, and then farther to the Bronx. It was on this road, Fifth Avenue West. The park divides the avenue into two one-way sections, you know, one going north, one going south, that I was later to run into a black Cadillac, which was running a red light on the edge of Harlem. In the darkness, I couldn't see the caddy from the side. That was a big deal, you know. In the day, they did a study of the safety risks of the rear taillights. The taillights you have now in the 21st century are an engineering marvel, designed for visibility. In those days, they designed it to be cool, and the caddy had these fins, you know. So you couldn't see the red lights unless you were behind the car. You couldn't see them from the side, nor could you see any of the front headlights. It was so weird. I'm driving right across the road, you know, like going right through the light, green light. Next thing you know, I'm like 1 or 2 feet in front of a black Cadillac on the edge of Harlem. It's so weird. I began to get a kind of a complex, you know, because towards the end of the time when I began to have enough money to get out of there, fly over to France, apply for l'École Supérieure des Beaux-Arts, get accepted, get denied the GI Bill from the State Department, is before I realized I could just sing on the metros for my support. I used to call it Maître de Trop, and went over to England, got accepted at Oxford, which, oddly enough, I could afford to go to Oxford with the GI Bill, which by then, apparently the Republicans, you know, it's like you begin to resent people like that. They had whittled down the GI Bill so that you couldn't get a college education from it. You tell me it isn't the Republicans. They seem to have their finger in all of those pies. You know, it's like Scrooge before he, you know, has his 180. So, yeah, hey, you know, it didn't hurt me. It's like, I was able to really get some stuff done anyway. Oh, so, anyhow. Yeah, so I went to Oxford, and then, hey, I dropped out, hit the road, and that's where I began to learn some. Don't learn it in college, kid. Maybe the Republicans did me a favor after all. Okay, so later in 1971, when I was driving in the ghetto near Delancey Street, in a wild and woolly East Village, yeah, so, okay, so we're getting sort of dreamy here. That's the idea of paintings. It's almost like a dream. You go to a gallery where the artists are worth their salt, and you're like in a dream. You almost lose, you know, the frame of reference fades out. That's one of the benefits of the human brain. You can begin to pick up on the utility of the, the medium. Next thing you know, it's your transport mechanism to I would say another world, but hey, we're talking more than a globe painting here. So when I got about the rock, I wonder if that got something in there. Yeah, the glacial erratic rock. I don't know if this is an erratic. I think erratics were supposed to be the huge boulders that were dropped. Oh, you think the glacier got down there, you think it dropped this huge rock and just left it on top of the ground? Could be, huh? The glacial erratic rock strewn throughout Central Park and everywhere in that part of New England are huge boulders left in place after the glaciers receded. I was sitting on one of these, taking in the scene and getting used to the inevitability of having to start my art career in New York City, which in reality seems to be one of the few places in, not to world, but in the world, little typo there, in the world for an artist to be, if he or she is to become seriously established, and that is to be as in etra. Okay, for example, while in New Hampshire, all the places I approached were interested in promoting their own precious local artists. You know, it's like going to Cornish. Let's say this place in Cornish. It wasn't, of course, it wasn't the store. I forgot. I think it was Larry's store or something. They took my stuff. No questions asked. It was terrific. I think they went out of business, though. You know, there was this insipid, unseen element, this undercurrent throughout the whole place. You know, they were interested only in promoting their own precious local artists in this other place. You know, as if I was, as I were trying to invade and interlope in their rightful territory. I mean, that's not how it works in the art world, you know, or it shouldn't. You know, it's like I did a painting, a drawing once of the Claremont City Hall, you know, and I went in, learned how to put the artwork on mugs. I went in and said, hey, you guys want to try to sell this as a souvenir? You know, it's like, what am I trying to do? I'm an artist, and I'm trying to support my work. Oh, wow. So you think I was trying to steal money or something by, trying to, earn a living with my art. So I went in there, and the guy says, well, you know what we think we're going to do is we're going to copyright City Hall. You know, so in other words, you know... Sure, you can sell it, kid, but every time you sell one of those, you better pay us a royalty. Imagine what happened if they did that with the Monet, who did, during the Franco-Prussian War, had to go, get out to England. In fact, the Germans did, crash his place, and they used it for a mess hall, and they said, what we do for the floor, we don't want to get it dirty. Oh, just throw these canvas down on there. You know, so they took these priceless Monet paintings that were done before the Franco-Prussian War, and they used it, as a floor covering on the mess hall with this, the troopers jumping over with the jackboots. You know, it's like, oh, my God. So we lost, probably about 50 works of art there. And it's like, okay, there's Monet over there, doing these beautiful paintings of, the Big Ben Tower over there, the Parliament Building, in the different aspects of sunlight. Can you imagine if they, they did that and said, oh, no, we've copyrighted the Parliament Building. I mean, they wouldn't do that. But, that's the kind of mentality. There in Claremont, what they did is they tore down their historic buildings. Some of that stuff went back to, pre-colonial era. Washington Street. They tore it down. Oh, we are going to be modernizing it. Next thing you know, there's a mart out there. And there's a, shopping center, French Fry Alley. Drug dealers packing Uzis in the parking lots. Yeah? What kind of creepy mentality is that? It just creeps me out just to think of it. But let's see, back to the glacial erratic rock. So, you know, let's face it, you're going to get anywhere, you've got to go to the city, like Mose Allison said, you know. When you go down to the city, boy, you better bring some cash. Because the people in the city don't mess around with trash. Okay, so, yeah, you know, you got to get away from the bumpkins, man.
Well, we don't take local artists here.
It's like, okay, where's the local artist? Let's see what this. This got to be cool. What kind of great movie?
Oh, well, they got to get cute little puppet dogs.
You know? All right, I'm out of here, buddy. You know?
You want the puppet dogs for the next 20 years? That's cool. We'll buy that.
No, I tell you what, just go over to, you know, the Mart and buy yourself a Raggedy Ann doll. That'll do you. You don't need art. Okay, so anyway, so New York. New York, huh? It seemed to be one of the few places in the world for an artist to be. He or she is to become seriously established. I mean, I think where else? France? Gosh, I don't know. London, maybe? I'm out of the loop, guys, anyway. But it took some getting used to being in the big city, man. I must say, I got over the culture shock rather quickly in spite of it all. Maybe it would have taken a little longer had I known what was ahead of me. Oh. Actually, I did know to a degree, but was, like everyone else, in a sort of a state of denial over it. Man, it's like Jewel the Denial or Denial, they talk about denial. This is where I hitchhike across from where this, not this promontory, where the, actually it's a lot bigger than it looks in the painting, but you have to sort of squeeze everything in. I was over here, held out my thumb, and a guy in a rowboat, one of the guys rowing around, leisure rower, came over, picked me up, dropped me across. I'll never forget it. I tried to offer him some bucks for the trip across. He said, get out of the boat. Let's see what we got there in that. The little lake. All right. Once I was almost late for an appointment at the Department of Parks in New York City. I was going to work for them. The summer of 66 as a lifeguard at the Carmine Street Pool. West Village, this is my neighborhood down there that I moved to. I got out of the subway on the wrong side of the park and started running across to the building, but it wasn't a straight shot. This lake was in the way. What to do? It was full of rowboats, so I stuck out my thumb and hitchhiked across the lake. Nice guy picked me up on the shore and dropped me off on the other side. So, well, we got something over here. What's that? The hills going to the edge of the park. Central Park is a really nice place to just take a walk, you know? Yeah, it's not like Men in Black where, you know, at least it wasn't when I was there. Anyway, even though it's packed on the weekends, there's still lots of room to get around. Heck, these days you can actually get a rickshaw, one of the Yankee coolies to take you through the park. It's kind of neat, you know, human-powered vehicle. It's actually fun. I know, so I was one of those pedicabbers. I used to operate a pedicab in Skagway, Alaska. It's not actually Skagway, it's Chukokaway, you know, where the river meets the sea. But anyway. But the roads going through the park are also used for cycling and jogging, as well as bridle path for the horses, you know, horseback riding. So it's really something. So in the painting, they tend to disappear in the mist. The atmospheres of a very foggy day help to transform the city from this central location in the park. I think that's it. You know, it's got this, That's the hills. We got the willow. We got this bank. That's the hills. I think we did it. Okay, well, that's the story on that. That's pretty neat, huh? Let's have a look at the background, the BG for the painting here. And then we'll just sort of... this is Flowers by a New Hampshire Forest Gallery 4. Chark 100, image 1, 3, 2. And it's supposed to be a copy. Here's the next one. Yeah, I was using a special filter done by the Microsoft company back in the early part of the 21st century, 2002. This is called, the filters are called, filter series here is called Impressionist, I think it is. Twin pines going up to the sky.